worship know your praise. We're gathered under your name. We are a tide that's rising, and we cannot be contained. No, no.
Good morning. Welcome to Spirit of God Fellowship. It's good to see you this morning. It's good to see you. It's good to see my Bible, but I'll need my glasses. It's good to be together. starting to get used to being together again on Sunday mornings. It's a good thing. I love it. So thanks for coming. We had, for those of you who were able to make it, we had a wonderful time yesterday at our memorial service for dear brother Dave Stromberg, who passed away in April, as you know. But we just had a great time. So thank you all for coming. Jim and his wife. Jim is one of Dave's brothers, also kind of one of the original members of Spirit of God Fellowship. So Jim and his wife Robbie are back there, just kind of wave. There they are. Yep. So thanks for coming. Jim was with our church back 40 years ago, I think. 30, 40 years ago. So they drove in, and Dave's brother Doug was here, the older brother. Some of you know him. And so many people shared. It was really cool. For those of you who were here, we saw a little different side of Dave that we didn't know. You know, that was fun. It was really cool. But continue to pray for the Stromberg family as they as they mourn and then make that transition from mourning to going on with the next phase of their lives. I have been in contact with Joe DeVito, Mary Jo's son, and we are planning a memorial for Mary Jo sometime in October. So we'll have more details on that. That's about it for now. We don't have a whole lot of announcements. Pray for us as leaders. We would and you know, feel free to communicate with us, because we have to start determining what we do with Sunday school and that whole deal, you know, because that's coming up. So we actually have a meeting, I believe Monday, tomorrow night, I believe, right? I think so. I'll have to check my calendar. And but we're open to discussions on this. I don't know, everybody's on different sides of the fence on that one, so we'll have to talk that one through. But this morning, Mathew James is speaking. Always love it when he is here. What I want to, or when I grow up, I want to be like a child. Is that right? That's the title of his message. So we look forward to that. Next week, I'm going to be speaking on courage. How many of you know in these days we need courage? And we're going to need more courage. So I'm going to spend a couple weeks on courage. And, you know, when you talk about courage in the Bible, you go to Joshua, don't you? So we're going to talk about Joshua. And then I'm taking another bite out of the book of Daniel. We're going back to Daniel, because Daniel had a lot of courage. So speaking of courage, here's the scripture for this morning. It's Galatians. Don't turn, I'll just read it to you. Galatians 6, verse 9. Let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing. I think Doug shared yesterday that there's a blessing coming. There's a harvest coming. There's a revival coming, but then this scripture ends. We will reap a harvest of blessing. Church, it says, if we don't give up. We can't give up. Let's enjoy some time with our worship team, and then Mathew will come up and speak.
Come exalt his name forever.
every day and night, never ending praise. May our written letter get us blessed, Lord. Every day and night, never ending praise. May our incense rise, let us bless the Lord.
You were good to me.
searching for the kind we've been looking for, the kind we've been hungry for, the kind of love we want. What kind of love is this? Yeah. It is here for the have, here for the take, here for receiving. There's no shadow you'll light up, mountain you'll climb up, coming after me. There's no war you won't kick down, now you'll tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you'll light up, mountain you'll climb up, coming after me. Oh, you were thirsty. No wall you won't kick down, lie you all dead air, coming after me. And don't shine you on lighter, mount you on climber, coming after me. No, no, no. No wall you won't kick down, lie you all dead air, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up. Coming after us, coming after us with goodness, not anger. Coming after us with love and not abandonment. Coming after us with safety. They're coming after us with love, and you're casting out all fear. With mercy, Jesus. You're coming after us again.
So we say more, Lord. We want more. We need more. We're asking for more. We believe you for more. There's always more in you, God. There's always more in your Son, more in your Spirit. And that's what we want. We want more. Thank you, God. Thank you, worship team. Thank you so much. All right, good morning, everyone. See this scattered crowd? You guys aren't too close to one another, are you? All right, I want you to think of your name. That didn't take much, did it? Just think of your name. Hold on to that. Hold on to your name. Because we're going to talk a little bit about names today. For boys, before they reach the age of 15, the top three dream jobs are professional athlete, doctor, and musician. For girls, the top three dream jobs before age of 15 are teacher, doctor, and veterinarian. So, and that's changed over the course of history, but one thing you'll never find kids asking to be when they grow up is a kid. Kids aren't saying, I want to just be a kid. They're always thinking beyond their age range and their ability. They want to reach for something a little bit further than where they are. And so for us as Christians, one of the gifts that God has given us is that we get to grow. We get to grow up. And everyone wants to grow. The opposite of growing would be stagnation. It would be death. You don't want to not grow. So I'm saying that today God has planned a life of endless growth for us, where we grow in wisdom, we grow in grace, we grow in love, we grow in goodness. But sometimes as we're walking with Jesus Christ, as we're trying to serve him, as we're trying to get a handle on our lives and on his life in us, around us, things can just almost get in the opposite, go in the opposite direction of what it seems like we're really trying to attain. So sometimes our hearts get a little brittle, get a little bitter. And you can see it by how much you accept other people. One way you can tell that your heart is tender, your heart is a muscle, that it's pliable, is how you accept other people. That would be sinners and saints. That would be people in the church, people outside of the church. How do you accept them? Do they feel wanted by you? Do they feel allowed to breathe and live by you? Do they feel accepted by you? Do you create space for them to walk in and be who they are? Just be themselves. It's a gift that God's given us because Jesus accepted us. We all know that. We believe that. And our hope is on that. Jesus, you accepted me. And now I'll turn to accept others the way you accepted me. So, Jesus' answer sometimes to our mindset is to hold up children as a model for humility, revelation, inheritance. You know, one of our goals is to become like little children. That's what Jesus said. So, to those who think they're somebody, and to those who think they're nobody, it's different than that. It's what God thinks you are. It's what the Father says you are. That's what's true about you and I. So you are what the Father says you are. You're a daughter. You're a son. You're a holy one. You're a dearly loved one. You're blameless. You're his body. You're his bride. That's who you are. That's who you are. He wants to drop names into your being this morning so that you can grow deeper in this whole identity that he's given you. He's given you a new identity. And we've just got to go deeper into this new identity that Jesus has given us. Daughter, son, holy one, dearly loved, blameless, his body, his bride. Think about that name you were given at birth. When's the last time you questioned whether it was your name or not? I don't think anybody in the room has ever questioned, like, is my name really Bill? Because it's just woven into your very being that your name is your name. That you are what your parents called you, what they came up with. So sometimes that works for us and sometimes not. Maybe if you could throw up that name, Paul. Have you seen this name? This is Elon Musk, the founder of Tesla. This is what he named his son. Did you guys read about this? No? This is true. This is a name. X Ash A12 Musk. And I'm not going to go into the meaning. There's meaning behind the name, but this might be one of the times where a kid thinks, man, my dad didn't get it at all. He missed it. He missed this by a mile. This is, I'm stuck with it. Just call me X. Call me Ash. Call me something. So no matter what that kid thinks about his name, that's the name his parents gave him. And it's going to stick. It's going to stick. So the name that the Father has given you is meant to stick. It's meant to follow you for the rest of your life. So in Matthew chapter 18, verses 1 through 4, it says this: at that time, the disciples came to Jesus saying, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And calling to him a child, he put him in the midst of them and said, truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus brings before his disciples, his followers, and before us this perfect model of what it means to be someone who's ready and willing to enter into his kingdom underneath his authority, alongside of him. And he brings up a child and he says, you have to humble yourself like this child. You know what's tough about humility? It's like as soon as you start thinking about it, you've lost it. As soon as you start saying, oh, I'm really going to be humble today. I'm really going to strive to be a more humble person. It's like the conversation just sort of just leads you down a dark alley. It's almost like humility is for those who are not thinking about it. It's for those who are reaching out to Jesus, lost in his service, in his doings, in what he's up to. And humility is something that's sort of woven on the inside of you as you're doing what you're supposed to do. So there's no humility contest. You can't stack yourself up against another person and say, I'm a little bit more humble than he is. I just feel it. It just really seems like that to me. It's gone. Doesn't happen like that. And so we need to always remember what the Father has called us. Sometimes names get stolen. Stolen identity. Years ago, one of our kids, applied for a loan, a college loan, and he got rejected. And as we looked into why he was rejected, we came to find out that someone had stolen our identity. They had taken our name and our social security number and created a people's gas account in the city of Chicago. We didn't even live in Chicago at the time, but they used our name to create a people's gas account. So I'm going through papers of bills, people's gas in a variation of my name, but with my social security number. And it took about 6 months for me to get my identity back. My identity was stolen. And I was the person that had to work hard to get this identity back. Endless copies of birth certificates, licenses, electric, gas bills I had to send off. And I want to say this. Some of you may have had your identity stolen. But the identity that God has for you and says about you has been stolen. Sometimes just through not paying attention, gets stolen. I've only been pickpocketed once. But it was when I was sleeping. Caught the L on the train on 95th Street and thought I'd take a nap on my way to work. That was my problem. No, you don't nap on the L. With one of my cheeks, hanging off the seat with the wallet inside. How long ago, how dumb could I be? And I got ripped off. Had it stolen just because I wasn't paying attention. I was sleeping when I should have been alive and alert, aware of my surroundings. I don't sleep on L's anymore. I'd rather stand than sit. Some of us in the room have had our identity stolen. We don't think of ourselves the way that the Father thinks about us. We don't call ourselves son, daughter, beloved, blameless, faithful, the body, the bride. We use other names about ourselves. So Satan not only wants to steal our identity, he wants to replace our identity with other words. He wants us to think of other names for ourselves. And so Satan tries to convince us that we don't have what God says we have. We're not called who God says we are. And so Satan has his own grouping of names. It's too many to make a list of, but it's names like forgotten. Like you're forgotten. Other people are famous. Other people get recognition. Other people get credit. But they seem to have forgotten you. Another name is guilty. No matter how much you ask for forgiveness, no matter how many times you say, God, I'm sorry, you're still guilty. You can't shake it. It just won't leave you alone. Another name is abandoned. You're abandoned. People gave up on you. Someone significant gave up on you. And you can't shake that feeling of, I'm just out here like in a desert all by myself. Satan's job is to not only steal our names, but give us substitute names that occupy our brain, that keep us feeling distant from God when He's so close. There's a line in a song, can't even think of the singer. No, it's not coming. Jason. Who? Upton. Jason Upton. One song he says, God is the reason that you whisper because you're only a step away. Is that why he makes a statement, something like, sometimes it's hard to hear you because you're whispering, but maybe the reason you're whispering is because you're this close to me. You're this close to me, and what else would he do but whisper? So I'm here this morning to help all of us get our name back. If it's been stolen at all, to help us to remember who we are. If we've been given substitute names. And so to those who think they have a lot, or to those who think they have very little, the truth is that you have what belongs to your Father. That's what you have. It's more than a little, it's more than a lot, it's more than anything you can imagine. You have what belongs to your Father. And we need to get comfortable with this truth that we have an inheritance that is way beyond what we'll ever earn, what we'll ever strive for. It's just way beyond. That's our inheritance. I've said this before, you know, I mean, when you're a kid and you feel comfortable, one of the signs of being comfortable in your house is that the fridge belongs to you. When you're a kid, one of the best things about life when you're a kid is that you can go inside the refrigerator and just grab food and eat it. You've been given permission by your parents. You know, if you get hungry, just go in the fridge. Just go get something. You're like, oh my gosh, they haven't seen me going to the fridge lately. God's fridge is open for you. You can go anytime, any place, into the presence of God, and it's like a wide open refrigerator. Whatever you need, just grab it. Whatever you need, just grab it. So, your name is what God says you are. You have an inheritance of what the Father has. And so let's look at a couple more passages of Scripture. Luke 18, let's do that one. Luke 18, 15 through 16. It says, now they were bringing even infants to him, that would be to Jesus, that he might touch them. And when the disciples saw it, they rebuked them. But Jesus called them to him, saying, he called the children, called the people, let the children come to me, and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. So Jesus makes this radical statement, that it's to people who are like children, that's who the kingdom belongs to. And in another passage, maybe we should read that one as well. Let's look at Luke chapter 10, verses 17 through 21. And this will be the last passage I read. And so you may have heard the story, sort of the backdrop. You may have heard the story about Jesus giving 12 of his disciples, the inner circle of his disciples, authority and power to go out and preach the gospel and to heal the sick. So he gave them this authority. And then chapters later, we don't know how long the time period is, but sometime later, he picked out 70 or 72 people and gave them the same authority and the same commission to go out, preach the gospel, and heal the sick. And so after the 72 came back, it says they returned with joy, saying, "Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name." And he said to them, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Behold, I have given you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." In that same hour, he rejoiced in the Holy Spirit and said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will." So here come the 72 back with joy because they saw the name of Jesus just cut through demonic oppression, cut through sickness, cut through fear. They saw people healed. They saw people delivered, people set free, and they were excited. I don't know if we just started listening to Francis Chan over at Harvey House. We're going to go through a series by Francis Chan, the Book of James. So Francis Chan recently, I think he already moved to Asia. They were moving to Hong Kong, he and his family. And then actually his son-in-laws prayed about it and they joined him. So the great majority of his family are living in Hong Kong. So this was a Chinese-American preacher, teacher, started a church. It grew like crazy. He broke away from that church so he could do something on a different scale where they met in house groups, where he didn't take a salary. It was really a radical move for him. And then he finally heard God speaking to him and his wife saying that they needed to move to Asia. So just before he went, he gave what's been called his last sermon to America. And one of the things about it is that he tells the story that of his 52 years of life, he had up until this point never seen the miracles he was longing to see. And in fact, he just came up in a church tradition that basically said that era of miracles is over. And Francis said, as he was at one meeting, everyone he prayed for, everyone he put hands on was set free, was healed. He said he prayed for a brother and a sister who were both deaf, and they both received their hearing while he was praying for them. And if you know Francis Chan, he's not a hype guy. He said nothing like this had ever happened to him before. And in fact, when it was over, he sent people to the home of those people to find out if they really were deaf. That doesn't happen that often. He wanted to make sure they were deaf and they weren't just plants in the audience. They were deaf. They couldn't hear. He laid hands on them and they could hear. So the 72 came back after experiencing what Francis Chan experienced. Real healing, real deliverance, people really being set free. That's part of your inheritance. That's part of your name. That's part of your calling. It's to pray for the sick and see them healed. It's to cast demons, evil spirits out of people. It's to proclaim the forgiveness of God for everything you've ever done. That's part of your inheritance. We should be walking up and down the earth proclaiming this forgiveness that God has given us. Can't you remember the day you were forgiven? Can't you remember what that felt like, what that sounded like, what the whole world was new? Everything was different. I mean, people have described that day as like the weights being taken off of your shoulders, like something, some shackle being just broken off of your mind. The ability to hear God for the first time. Having a direct answer to prayer from the Almighty God to you, just a you person. If you remember that, we should be walking up and down the earth giving this away. Because that's all you can do. All you can do is give away what you've been given. That's all you can do. And you give it away just as Jesus said, freely you have received, freely give. So, you may not know me, and so you wouldn't have a reason to trust me. You may know me, and you may still think you don't have a reason to trust me. But trust me on this. You are who God says you are. Trust me. That's who you are. You're his daughter. You're his son. You're his bride. You're his body. You're his household. You're his faithful ones. You're his holy ones. You are his blameless ones. You're his nation. You're all priests. You all can speak directly to your Father, and he will hear you. And so, why don't you don't have to close your eyes or anything. You don't have to hold out your hands, but you could. You could close your eyes. You could hold out your hands. Because I want to take back what Satan has taken from us. So, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I declare that these are your people. These are your children. These are your sons. They're your daughters. They're your household of faith. They're your chosen ones. They're your eternal sons and daughters. They belong to you. They don't belong to anyone else. They only belong to you. And so in the name of Jesus, we take back our identity this morning. We take back the name that God has given us. We remember what he's done for us. And we declare it over every evil thing inside, outside of us. In Jesus' name, we say this is true. This is truer than anything we've ever known, anything we've ever heard. And so let the name of God speak to you this morning. Let his grace just overwhelm you. Let the fire of God just burn away those false names. We cast down those false names of abandonment, of forgottenness, of unforgiveness, of guilty, of shame, of lostness, of darkness, of depression, of feeling overwhelmed. We cast those names down. And we accept the name that the Father has given us. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't we have the worship team come on up? And I forgot to do this. I was supposed to plug this. Somebody lost. I think it's a phone inside here. Anybody? No? Now I feel like I need to get rid of this. From yesterday. Okay.
Yeah. It was probably from your thing, Char. Okay, Mathew, thank you so much. God, oh man, that was fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. Again, I'm just trying to get used to a little bit of a different season here. Once again, our pattern's going to be a special song at the end. And so if you want to stand, great. But if you want to just sit and allow the team to minister to you, they're going to sing a closing song. Then I'll give a benediction, and we'll be on our way.
Comes to me, my will be done.
Thank you, team. Thank you, Joy. Joy Arrington. Thank you. Thank you for ministering to us. May God bless you. May God keep you. And may you go through this week realizing that he knows you, that he hears you, and that he names you. And your name is accepted. And your name is loved. And your name is forgiven. And your name is restored. Go with that in mind. God bless you. Have a great week, and we'll see you next week. Thanks for coming.